Hi, my name is Tom Chapin, and welcome to a future program here coming up of Just Outdoors. Hopefully you'll stay tuned. We have Mike Sundberg as a guest. Mike, you're going to be a great person to interview here because we're going to be talking about archery and the Thunderhawks Archery Club here in Grand Rapids, where there's about 200 kids involved. Just give a little overview of what we're going to be talking about here.
So we're going to be talking about the equipment they use, the competitions that they go through, the growth of the sport, and just in general overview of the program.
Sounds good. And these are going to be future hunters someday.
Future hunters. A lot of them.
Okay. Thank you. Hope you watch.
Just Outdoors is brought to you in part by the following community supporters.
Jervelin Hardware Hank, Deer River. Jervelin Hardware offers a broad selection of paints and sporting goods and a complete line of plumbing and electrical supplies. Jervelin Hardware, 108 Main Avenue, Deer River.
Meds One Emergency Medical Services. Meds One provides mobile advanced life support, community paramedic primary care services, and education, event medical support, and consulting. Preserving lives and improving health. In an emergency, always call 911.
This program is sponsored in part by Brood Awakenings Coffee House. Brood Awakenings is a green business with the mission to be a cafe where a person can eat every day and be healthy. Nurture your inner being at Brood Awakenings, downtown Grand Rapids on Highway 2 East, across from the courthouse.
Hi, my name is Tom Chapin, and welcome to Just Outdoors. This is a program to bring you the bare facts about the woods, waters, and wildlife of Itasca County. And today, our special guest is Mike Sundberg. Mike, thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
And Mike, you are the head coach for the Thunderhawks Archery Club.
Correct.
In Grand Rapids, Itasca County, the whole area here.
Correct.
And the reason I had you in here is because I think this is a real good club to promote archery, obviously, and to be a source for a lot of these kids for future hunting down the line. A lot of these kids that are in your club are probably thinking hunting down the line. They're fifth, sixth grade. We're going to talk about that. And also, what impressed me was the number of kids that you have in this club. We'll talk about that. And the fact that you're doing this with really no public funding, which is amazing. So first of all, tell us a little about Mike Sundberg and who you are, where you're from, and how you got into this.
Well, I'm Mike Sundberg. I moved to Itasca County, Grand Rapids about 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. My wife and I moved up here from Brainerd just shortly after our oldest son was born. And I got into the archery thing about 4 or 5 years ago with my son. He had picked up the skill or the class in school, became very interested in it, had expressed possibly wanting to go deer hunting later on or shoot something with a bow. There's a connection. But he was really passionate about the sport itself.
Yeah.
So we got involved that way as I started helping out. And then later on, Mr. Johnson, who originally started the program, was looking to ease his way out of the program, mm-hmm. and then had approached me about taking over. And so 3 years ago, I took over as the head coach for the program. And that's kind of where I got my start in the archery side of things.
Yeah, what's your professional background?
Professional background is I'm an environmental scientist. And then I work in town at MDI,
sure.
As the maintenance supervisor, and then doing some other.
Got to have an income besides.
Besides this. So okay. That's professionally an environmental scientist.
And you live in a rural area of the
very
county here.
Rural so area.
Very
of the
rural
county.
Area. Okay. All right. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to go through this whole program that you are heading.
Yep.
You've got a lot of help here, don't you?
We have a lot of help. Not only in coaches and parental support, but just in the community itself is a huge amount of help that we have.
Yeah. So. Okay. And we'll get into that. You're going to mention how many coaches that are going to take to do. But first of all, this is a club that's been going for how long?
This year is our 10th year.
Your 10th year?
10th year.
Okay.
The club.
And when you started out, how many kids did you have, maybe like your first couple of years?
I think if I remember correct, talking to Mr. Johnson, we looked at the picture. The original club 10 years ago, the original team had 10 archers.
10 archers?
10.
Okay. And now you're competing statewide and even national competition.
Yes.
With some of these kids. And how many kids do you have now?
This year we're expecting to have 200 kids on the team.
200 kids.
200.
And those are kids from the Grand Rapids, Itasca County area.
Yeah, those are just basically ISD 318, Grand Rapids, Robert J. Elkington Middle School, and Grand Rapids High School kids.
Just in Grand Rapids, 200 kids involved in
this. Just in Grand Rapids.
It's amazing. That is really amazing.
It's, yeah, just the sport is amazing at its growth, yeah. and that is amazing. The kids are just outstanding.
Yeah, and these kids really promote it. They try to come every week, or how often you have
So we have practice.
Practice and so on.
We have practice twice a week at the middle school, and we'll have all 200 of them there throughout the 2 days of practice.
Wow. So that takes a lot of help.
It does take a lot of help.
So let's talk about that.
All
how
right.
much help do you have?
So just coaches in general, we have 8 other coaches, I think if I got the numbers down correctly. We got Mr. Rich Will is one of the coaches. He's been with the program about 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
We have Ms. LeBoy, who is our program coordinator. As I've told everybody, she's the brains behind everything. She kind of coordinates it and keeps me on track. She has been with the program, I think, 7 years. Then we have Mr. Dennis Hansen, who mm-hmm. has been with the program for 3 years. We have Carrie Sundberg, my wife, who also participates in coaching. She's been with the program for 3 years now. And then we have Mr. Tatter from the school, helps with the program, so that's 5. And then Mr. Arnie Moe is another one of the volunteer coaches that we have. So
okay.
Those 6 are the main coaches.
Wow.
But we also go one step further, and we actually get some of our archers to be peer mentors and start the coaching process.
I see that. I saw some information on that where these kids, that must really be exciting for them to be in the program long enough to all of a sudden become a mentor to some of the kids that are coming into the program. So
yeah, and they're
amazing.
They're hand selected as leaders. They're,
sure.
They've shown leadership skills and the ability to lead and mentor other students. And as the paper mentioned, we pick them just because of those skills, and then they kind of go out and pick 3 to 4 archers that they mm-hmm. get to mentor. And we've seen that by doing that, these archers then pick up skills a little bit faster and they become more proficient. And then not only do the ones that they're mentoring, but then it helps them through their process too.
Sure.
And so we see it increase scores just in general throughout the entire program.
Well, before we get into the scoring and all that, take us through a week of practice, because I can't imagine 200 kids. How do you divide that up? And also the age groups here.
I'll start with the age groups. We basically take 5th through 12th graders onto the team.
So they start at 5th grade?
They start at 5th grade.
Okay.
And we'll take them from 5th to 12th grade. And then we practice 2 times a week at the middle school. That's divided up into, we have just about 4 hours of total practice time. 2 days a week.
Hours each?
Four hours each day. So 4 hours on Tuesday, 4 uh-huh. hours on Thursday. And we divide that up in the beginning part of the year, just new archers. If they've never been on the team before or haven't had the experience, we start with them. And we give them a couple of practices just to get everything going, mm-hmm. just to get them kind of on board. And then once we get into full practices, we divide that. We put the 5th and 6th graders together. And then we have the 7th and 8th graders together. And then we have the high school practicing together. So we divide it up about 1 hour and 20 minutes for each group to get their practice time.
So all these coaches that you mentioned are involved every week.
Every week.
Every week. So
every week.
You talk about dedication, right?
They are.
There's no pay here. There's no nothing. You have no income coming into this club. And the way you, I guess it sounds like the way you pay your expenses is you actually go out and try to solicit funding from groups in town, from people that are, you know, parents and the whole thing. What does it cost a kid to get involved in this for a year?
The cost of the program itself, if you add in the shirt cost, is right around $110.
$110.
And that cost is broken up into the use of the school bow. They don't have to go out and purchase their own bow or any of that. The use of the arrows all year long, plus the targets that we have to replace. As you imagine, 200 kids shooting at a target, they don't last very long. And then all of the entry fees for the Grand Prix and the state tournament are included in that $110.
Yeah, we're going to get into that.
How you progress through.
Right. But this is actually sponsored in a way by the Community Education.
Correct.
Foundation, yep. Right? In Grand
Rapids.
Grand Rapids,
yes.
What they do is they provide you with a person to take care of the expenses and money and stuff like that that comes in.
They're the fiscal agent and bookkeepers.
Bookkeepers, pretty much. So that helps.
Yes.
And the school district is helping you in a way by providing you a place to shoot, right?
Yeah, they provide facilities, which as the sport has grown, they've increased the amount of time that we get in the gym. So, I mean, they've been very supportive on that part of it by giving us those facilities. But that's where our support comes from the school.
Sure. But the amount of money a kid pays, $100 and some dollars, I don't know, do they pay $100 and some dollars?
Yep.
Okay. That doesn't cover...
That doesn't cover the complete expenses.
No.
Of everything that we do. So fundraising and some of this other stuff that we do is how we get additional income to do some of these other things.
Wow. So these kids come and you must have some dropouts as it goes through here, but probably not a high percentage. Huh?
There's a very low percentage of kids that start that year that don't finish the year. I think we may have two or three that start the year that don't finish. And then we really don't have a high dropout rate just year after year. We're still a very young team as far as, you know, only being 10 years into the program, we haven't seen a full class of seniors yet that have gone through. So this year we'll have our full class of juniors next year, so that the program really will mature at the end of next year.
Okay.
So we're gonna still see significant growth of the program.
Do you have kids that have hung with you all that time?
Yeah, we have some that started
fifth grade
that are now 11th graders, that have been there. Matter of fact, I think we haven't lost any of the 11th graders. So if they started in fifth grade, they're still with the program.
That's how much it means to them.
They get very passionate.
And their skill levels are getting pretty high, aren't they?
They are amazing archers. When you see them and you look back from where they were 5-6 years ago to where they are now, it's amazing.
So it sounds like, that's what's holding them in there too, is that it's good. They know how good they are. And then you compete.
Then we compete.
Okay, I don't know anything about that or where you go or what schools you compete against, but tell us how those brackets work and who you compete against to start with, the basic ones.
The basic, where you compete in a region two, and our regions are basically divided by the DNR regions. For region two here, we compete against schools, a school in Hill City.
That's like northeastern Minnesota.
Yeah, northeastern Minnesota. Okay. So we have Hill City, Hibbing, Mountain Iron, Mesabi East, Northwoods Cook, and Cromwell. So those seven other schools make up the region.
Does this competition like that level take place the whole year, or is it toward the spring?
It's a winter sport. We're starting practice actually this week. Will be our first practice. Our first Grand Prix is what we call those events, will be held in January. And then we have our state tournament that's held in March. So we'll have five regional Grand Prix, a regional championship, and then we'll go on to the state championship.
How many of these 200 kids wind up at some of these higher levels? How many do you take, like, say, to the state champion?
We take the entire 200 of the state.
Oh, you do?
Yep.
That's got to be...
it's exciting. Last year at the state tournament, there were 1,200 kids that participated throughout the whole entire state.
And 200 of them were from Grand Rapids, Minnesota?
Yeah, right about 200 of them are from Grand Rapids.
And how many schools are you looking at there approximately for the state?
For the entire state, there's probably, I think, right around 40. schools that participate.
So Grand Rapids must be the top numbers.
We're one of the close in numbers as far as the number of archers on a team. There are a couple of schools in the cities that are right up there.
Okay.
They have a larger draw, obviously, population. But
so you got regional, and then what?
We got regional and then state.
And then state, okay. So let's stop there for a minute. You have, your club has won trophies, haven't you?
Yes.
Placed some pretty high numbers.
Yeah, we have, last year, our fifth graders, were state champions. And so they surprised a lot of people last year down at the state tournament. For a bunch of first-year archers that had never touched a bow 4 months before, to go down and become state champions.
That's something to say about the trainers, right?
Coaches. I don't take it that way. I take it to the kids.
Well, of course, but they still have to be.
They have to be taught. So
focused on something.
Yeah. And again, I think the entire coaching staff and this mentorship program that we've put in has really helped out. So
boy, what a great sport for the community here.
It is.
And the reason, again, you're on the show here, it's an outdoor show, but these kids are going to be hunting in the future.
Yeah.
And archery is getting to be such a huge outdoor sport for everything.
Very popular.
They hunt pretty much everything now with a bow.
Yeah, they're hunting. Like. You know, we've had a couple of archers that, you know, they started off going, you know, this is to get me to be more proficient so I can hunt a bear, hunt a deer, hunt a turkey, hunt a pheasant. I mean, you know, when you've seen pheasant hunting with a bow, and that's quite the shot, you know. So that's, and these kids are, you know, some of them, that's where they want to go, and others they prefer the target archery.
Sure. So, well, do you have a kind of a percentage of that? Did you take a survey?
Yeah, we kind of took an unofficial survey over the last couple of years for one of our sponsors, because they want to know the information. And about 30% say that they plan on continuing on into some hunting segment.
Hunting segment.
We're starting to see that number grow.
I would
every
think
year,
so.
You know, as they get more and more into it.
Well, you aren't into the senior yet.
Yeah, we're not into
it. You're going to hear a lot about it. That's the age bracket right there.
Yeah, so.
That's really good. Okay, you got competition on the state level now. And you go to that once?
Once a year. Yep.
And you've done very well the last
Had some teams that have finished very high. We have an individual overall state female champion on the team. She's won it twice. The first time she won it, she was a sixth grader. And the second time she was, if I remember correct, ninth grade.
Ninth grade, wow, so. Okay. Now you're talking about national level. What's that involve?
So national levels is you have to have a qualifying score at the state tournament. Mm-hmm. And then you take a team down to Louisville, Kentucky.
How many?
There's 24 archers on a team, so whatever teams qualify. So we'll take the 200 and we divide that up in the elementary team, the middle school team, and the high school team. 2 years ago, we took a middle school team and a high school team down to the national tournament.
This is where your expenses are a problem.
That's where the expenses really hit in.
But that's why you got to kind of go out in the community and say, hey, look at this program.
Yep.
We got a couple hundred kids out of your community here, and we need a little help here since we're not being covered by public funds, you know.
Sure.
Some of these schools are, though, aren't they? You're competing against schools that are.
Yeah, there are some that have public funds brought into it, highly paid coaches.
Really?
That we're competing against. So the archery is one of those, especially for me, it's one of those that I don't think the money plays, you know, as far as the competition side, because we level the playing field with the equipment we use.
And so we're going to get into that. Interesting.
Yeah, so all of the equipment is a level playing field.
Right.
So
everybody's using the same thing.
Exact same bow.
Statewide, nationwide, right?
Statewide, national.
So when you go down to Kentucky, it's same bows.
And actually, all the way to the world tournament. Because they bring in teams from all over the world. They've expanded this program into Africa, into Europe, into Canada, into all over the world. So we actually have a world competition that we can also qualify for.
And is that held different spots every year?
World is held at a different spot every year. Last year it was in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Really?
It had been in St. Louis, Orlando, but it's always held in the U.S.
Have you ever been to one of those?
I haven't been to a World. We've been to Nationals. World is a goal.
There's a goal. Yeah, so. You never know. Especially with these kids.
The way these kids are shooting. Without a doubt, it'll come. We'll have. Yeah. I think we have the potential of having multiple world champions.
Wow, right out of Grand Rapids.
Well, and the amazing thing is these kids will be world champions before they leave high school.
Yeah, just amazing. Yeah. And a lot of these kids are in sports, in this particular sport, because they don't have any interest in some of the other sports, right?
Yeah, we have a few of them that, you know, they don't fit in, or they just don't, you know, don't enjoy the other sports.
Right.
And this one, archery community in general is just a lot different. And that's kind of where I got involved with it, was at one of these Grand Prix events with my youngest son, and one of the archers that he was competing against had actually stopped in the middle of the competition to give him advice on how to improve himself. You don't see that in a lot of other sports, but you see it time and time again with this sport.
Sure. Isn't that great?
For kids to help another kid
and the camaraderie that must go on there because of that.
Yeah,
it's knowing they're kind of special.
Yeah, with my sons, both of them are in the program, and they now have friends from all these other schools that, you know, they look forward to going and having the friendly competition, but then just hanging out with, you know, kids from other schools. So,
do these other schools in the area and the region have pretty good facilities like you do here?
All the schools, you know, are, you know, of course, because it's not a school-sponsored sport, there's, you know, always some give and take on that, but, you know, there's pretty good support, and I think as a sport throughout all of the schools, we're getting a lot more support as the popularity of the sport grows.
Great. So. Okay, we're to that stage. You talk about leveling the playing field. The only way you can have just the perfect competition with all these different kids and all their abilities is to have the same exact equipment for everybody.
Correct. Right?
And that's with every, I mean, the football is the same football, no matter where you go. So here you got the equipment that is the same. So tell us a little about the equipment that you're using, and then you got an example here.
I got
also
an example. So the bow that we're using was designed specifically for the NASP program. And they had went out and they'd asked manufacturers to, you know, design this bow that can be used from somebody from fifth grade all the way up to 12th. So you have a range of people, sizes and everything else, that kind of looks like one of the popular compounds, but maybe not act like a compound, maybe more of a recurve, you know, type of thing. So if you think about that, that's just a feat of engineering that is amazing, in the fact that you can take this bow from a fifth grader to a 12th grader and it shoots the same across the board.
Is it the same bow?
It's the same bow.
You mean the 12th grader shoots the same bow as the 5th grader?
Yep. That's the only Matthews Genesis is the only authorized bow down to the same arrow. You know, everybody shoots the exact same arrow, you know.
With the same arrow?
Yep.
How about the pull?
So that is the only adjustable part of the entire bow, is the draw weight. The draw length is based on the archer itself. So that's where it acts like a recurve, because it will stop depending on the draw length of the archer.
But the arrows are the same length?
The arrows are the same length.
So some of these kids have an arrow that hangs off the bow a little bit farther than the other kids. I mean, you got a lot of different size individuals here, but yet they're using the same bow. It's just amazing.
And again, it's a marvelous feat of engineering for this bow on what it can do in that range.
And they can adjust the poundage or the
poundage
pull
goes from
that,
a 12 to a 20 pound.
That's adjustable.
That's adjustable.
And there's no let off.
There's no let off.
And so tell the public what let off is.
So let off on a compound is once you get kind of over the edge, as you're pulling back the bow, you may be pulling back at 60 or 65 pounds, but then it lets off so that when you're holding it at full draw, it only feels like you're holding 18 pounds. Compounds do that, recurves don't. They actually increase as you're drawing back, and then you're holding the entire 20, 30, 40 pounds, whatever that is.
Right, so these don't.
They have no let-off, so if you're pulling 12, you're holding 12. Okay. If you're pulling 20, you're holding 20.
And what are these, 12 to what?
12 to 20 pounds.
12 to 20 pounds. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it shouldn't be too hard for a fifth grader, even a small statured fifth grader, to hold a 12-pound bow. Shouldn't be too
No, it's not. Some of them do have a couple of issues, and NASP and Matthews had addressed that very early on. They actually make what they call a Genesis Mini. And so it's a smaller version that adjusts from 8 to 12 pounds. So we may start them on a Mini to get them worked up to the 12 pounds, but then get them, they have to shoot this original in competition. Okay. So,
two more things on that.
Okay.
We're gonna. The one thing I thought was they don't use sights. This is all instinctive.
All instinctive shooting.
That's amazing. I mean,
it really is.
Yeah.
You know,
they have to know. That's what they learn.
That's what, and that's what we teach them is you know, instinctive shooting, and you know, there's some discussion out there on how much that then helps them later on when they switch over to a compound with sights, and you know, we develop a form with them, and you know, so if they can develop the form and the instinctive shooting, it just adds success to their compound shooting.
How about the distance that you shoot?
So we shoot two different distances at a competition. We shoot 10 meters and 15 meters. So
15 meters, that's 50 feet, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. Right close to 50 feet.
Wow, that's a long ways because, because when I was shooting competition with pistol, that's what we shot.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like a long ways. And here you're shooting almost 50 feet with a 20-pound bow.
With a 20-pound bow.
And it's just amazing, and no sights.
No sights.
And they group pretty good after a while, huh?
They. Like I said, I mean, you look at these kids, and we see it every year from where they start the beginning of the year and to where they end at the beginning of the year, and it's amazing what they do. They are
good group of archers. The information that you give, do you have any handouts? Is there a handbook that they can read or anything on this?
Yeah, there's plenty of websites that, you know, NASP in itself is a National Archery in the Schools program, so it's taught in the school system, and that's kind of our connection back to the school. Usually taught in a gym class, and so they get a basic there, and they have several training aids, and they start a form process with them as far as, you know, what form we like to shoot, and then, you know, they have training videos, and so NASP has a great program that they use.
These bows, you have any problem with left and right handers? How do you adjust for that?
They come in left or right handed,
okay.
So
let's see it.
This is the Matthews Genesis bow that we use. And of course, I have the right-handed version here. Again, very popular, it looks like the popular compound.
It does. It looks just like a compound bow.
Just like a compound bow with the cam on the bottom and the idler wheel on top.
Okay.
And
so functioning, is it more like a compound than it is a recurve? It's obviously not a recurve.
I would say that in a partial, it's like a recurve, and then again, this is one of those, it looks like the popular compound, but it acts a little bit more like a recurve only because we use finger release. We don't use any releases or anything else, and then all instinctive. So when it, you know, using a finger release, they've designed this so that it can be used for a finger release. There is a difference when you do a finger release on your regular compound on how the string moves and then the paradox of the arrow itself. So it's kind of designed that out of it. And again, looks very, you know, like a compound, but it's kind of that dual action.
Yeah, it's an amazing piece of engineering there. I'm trying to figure out how it really, it's simple in a way, but yet to come up with this was amazing.
Yeah, it was. It's, again, a simple, you know, design, and here's where we can adjust the draw weight.
Okay.
And again, that's the only part that we can adjust on it, and uses a pretty simple rest.
Yeah, the rest there, okay, and the arrows you shoot have just normal fledging along
the arrows
side.
We shoot our Easton 1820 arrows. So
if anybody's into archery shooting, they know what that is.
They'll know what that 1820
means. The 1820
means.
Is the diameter and also the thickness, right?
Correct. Okay. So this is the only arrow allowed in the NASP program.
That's it, right?
That's
there.
That's it, right there.
Very light, aluminum, obviously.
Yep.
And you know, you're not going to have any a miscalculation because they're going to stay straight, aren't they? They aren't like a wood arrow or something.
Yep, and amazingly enough, we spin arrows after every tournament, and we probably, and it's another one of our expenses, we probably replace 10%. And again, as those kids start getting them grouped in there really tight, and then they have to pull them out, they get tweaked a little bit, so the aluminum will bend.
Well, there's another expense.
Yeah. They're, yeah, so
this club had to buy those bows, right?
So we purchase bows every year, either to replace some of our old ones or just to keep up with the number of archers. In the last 2 years, we've purchased over 30 bows.
Wow.
And we go through...
They don't look cheap.
They're actually not very expensive when you buy them through the program.
Okay.
Because there's some, you know, you can buy them at several of your local outdoor shops, you know, mm-hmm. here in Itasca County or any of the big box stores. And they're about $170 in that range for those.
Yeah, but you got how many kids? And
yeah, we have a lot of kids. And like I said, through the NASP program, which the schools and our program is allowed to buy, it is a little bit less expensive, but not much.
Mm-hmm.
But and then they require maintenance every year, you know. The strings and cables need to be replaced, especially because we have so many kids shooting them.
Do you have to lubricate those?
Yeah, we put bow wax. We put bow wax and we keep the strings waxed up and, you know,
okay.
do your normal maintenance just like you would on most bows.
Amazing. So a kid that comes into the program can pick up any bow and shoot it. She doesn't get the same bow every week.
We assign, you know, some of them will share. Some kids do share bows, but we assign them one for all year long. It stays at the school and stays with the program, but we number these, and then that way they know how it reacts, because some of these will react differently just because of the tuning aspect of it. There are some minor tuning you can do. So we get them, you know, kind of using the same bow, and then if they start seeing or hearing something with it, they know, and they can tell us.
So, sure, after they're in the program for a while, they
start knowing.
Make the difference there, huh?
They know how to tell. So.
What's amazing to me is the fact that you're shooting so instinctively with this. You're not using any sights. You're not using any particular advanced
No advanced arrow rest breakaways.
Like do they use finger gloves on strings?
Some of them will use tabs.
Tabs, yes.
Some of them do use finger gloves. We tend to try to steer them away from finger gloves just because of the hooking that we have to do with this bow and trying to get a deep hook in there. The gloves won't really allow that, but finger tabs will.
Well, I would think the less you'd use, the more accurate you would become afterwards, because you are instinctively shooting.
Yes.
It's the feel of that string also.
That is part of it. Plus, I mean, if, you know, there's going to be people out there, if you're doing it right, and Mr. Moe has been around archery for a very long time. He's been my mentor through the coaching process. Will tell you, if you're doing it right, your fingers won't get sore, you know, just because of the way that everything's set up. So.
Well, I suppose they got to build up a little bit.
They got a little bit of a callus, but not
but
much.
That's it, yeah.
So
when you, what type of finger release do you have there with the arrow? Is it all three fingers underneath, or is it like you normally shoot with in between, or what is
it? No,
that?
We do a three fingers under.
Three fingers under?
Yep.
Well, see, that would be...
So, and most of your, you know, your traditional archers do the split, you know, two up,
correct.
You know, two below and one above. We teach the three under. Just again, that was NASP trying to keep it on more of a basic, you know, so that it's the same. Now, as our archers progress, some of them we do move to a one over, but then you have to realize you have to change your knocking locator,
sure.
you know, and some of the other, because
sure.
all of that's going to change with that. And so the reason we try to keep with a three under is so that these knocking points are, these knock locators are the same for every archer. Because if they're sharing a bow and one's going to decide to shoot, you know, two under or split finger, and the other one's shooting three, you can't keep changing.
I would think that would be almost impossible to have the changes.
Yep.
It's difficult to start with anyway,
yep.
and then you have to get them mentally and physically adjusted to where that is. And once they adjust to that, it's not going to be a problem.
Yep.
Is this, when you set this according to the rest, is just a little bit higher, or is it perfectly?
It's a little bit higher. 3/8 of an inch is where NASP and Easton and Genesis says. As you're pulling it back, it kind of levels out. Plus, where your fingers, you're trying to get that center point through a proper body alignment type of thing.
That's something I think that some archers aren't aware of, and they make a mistake on that. They don't raise that very high.
Yes.
Anything else you want to talk about on that piece of equipment there?
No, it's actually a very fun bow to shoot. People kind of look at it and they you know, they think it's just, you know, kind of a kid's bow. We all have one in our family, and it's actually fun to just take, you know, my wife, myself, and our two kids go up to the range and we shoot. And we don't get an excuse that they have more experience, or they don't get an excuse that we have a different bow,
same,
you know, because it's the same exact equipment. So it's really fun. So even we know a lot of other families that have actually went out and purchased these also to have that type of fun with their family. So
sure. This isn't a stabilizer, is it?
No, it's just
something to keep the strings separate.
Keep the string and the cable separate. So it's the slide, the guide.
Yeah.
So as it opens up, it's just a place to guide it.
When you're doing competition, either statewide or national, is there a maximum age?
Maximum age?
Age, yes.
Senior in high school.
So they could be 19 years old and be a senior in high school
whatever. So it's based on the grade that they're...
Basically a senior in high school.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So. Boy, we learned a lot here on this program.
Well, wow. Good. I hope a lot of other people have learned a lot about the sport of archery, especially how it relates to the Thunderhawks archery.
Well, I bet you there's a lot of folks out there that been living in this community for a long time that aren't aware this program's going on.
Yeah.
There's another archery club in town, too.
There is a Grand Rapids Archers. Mm-hmm. They have a facility up on 38 off Peterson Road. It's a great, great group. They support our team a lot. And we try to support them back. You know, they've let us use their facilities for training and for practice when we're not able to get into the schools. You know, so great group of archers up there.
Well, your club is strictly for kids, and they have combination of everybody. So you are providing them with future members too, probably.
We hope so.
On the line.
We hope so.
Yeah, it's just a great sport. This is community is something else when it comes to things like this.
It is.
You know, hopefully you can continue getting support for this. And I think the more it's talked about, like in the local paper here, and the kids talk it around, look at how it's grown.
It's
in the 10 years. So
grown.
I can't think of anything better in the winter, too.
For being warm and inside.
Inside,
yeah,
man.
It's perfect.
Having competition, the camaraderie, just fantastic. So, well, I thank you, Mike.
Well, thank you, sir.
Sundberg, for coming in.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
You betcha. And we'll be probably talking in the future and see how this thing is going.
We will.
Okay,
all
great.
Right.
Good luck. Good luck on your competition.
We appreciate it.
2014.
Thank you.
And thank you, folks, for watching Just Outdoors, and stay informed.